You know, he built that farm, you know, and he had a pretty darn nice house there. You know, at that time, I remember when kids were just little, we'd go over there.
Mm-hmm.
And
that's when they had the old ice box.
Yeah.
Where you put the ice in.
And then Grandma, she had what they call the parlor. And then that's where she had all her red, you know, over velvet overstuffed furniture.
Mm-hmm.
And the organ. And then that door was locked. Only when company come, they would open that.
Oh.
You know, that's the way they
work. Is that house still standing?
Yeah, but it has been remodeled. It's right north. It's right north of Isanti. It's where that chicken farm.
Mm-hmm.
And then they had that sitting room, you know, that I was talking about with all that nice furniture and everything.
Yeah.
Then they had what they called... a parlor.
Yeah.
I know both mother and dad, I think mother did go to an English school when she came to this country, because she was only about, I think mother was only about 3 years old. You see, Amy and I were younger, and I remember when the Robert would talk about Amy and I, you know what they called us? The small girls. Because we were the youngest.
Peter died, and there was no relatives that could read Swedish then, was there, after he died?
Well,
he was the only one. None of you girls could read.
Alyce was pretty good in Reuben. Yeah. And then Alyce is pretty good at it.
Fun to read Swedish. I mean, they sit there and pick out a word.
Yeah, you understand
and
it. Yeah.
The sentence together.
Yeah. But not, we very seldom talked it at home. I knew what they were talking about because we understood everything, but as far as speaking it, not very fluently. No. Dad's mother, she was very hunched like that when she got old.
Oh.
And I gotta see if George has got that picture.
Right, very hunched over, huh?
Uh-huh.
And, yeah.
And, you know, Dad went back to Sweden once to visit her. And I remember that was when we got our first, when Dad got the first car, the Chevy.
Mm-hmm.
Then he went to Sweden. And, I don't know. Here, gosh, you know, I got some information here that I didn't know I had. Mother and Dad moved from the Edna Relius farm to Woodham, October 23rd, 1903.
Oh, gosh, 1903?
Yeah. And Dad came to Isanti June 17, 1892. And Mother came to America 1881. So evidently, Grandma was here before Grandpa, before my Dad came to this country. So I suppose Peter Hogberg came
from, how do you pronounce that?
Berkshire.
Sweden.
Mother came to America in 1881, so that's when Peter Hogberg came to America.
Uh-huh.
From Berkshire, Sweden, at the age of, she was 10 years.
At the age
years.
Of 10.
Yeah.
And then she married June 9th of 1895 to Peter Ostberg.
Yeah, and then she stayed at father's farm.
At her father's farm.
Yeah, 1895 to 97.
1897.
Oh, yeah, and they rented Norelius Farm by Isanti for 7 years and bought a farm at Woodham.
Woodham.
Lived there for 29 years. Sold and bought a place by Woodham store in 1935.
Uh-huh.
And they had the auction sale November 26, 1935.
You know, what auction sale is that, Ines?
That was the farm, you know, when they broke up, when Grandma went into the nursing home.
Oh.
So that was it.
You don't think there's any Jewish background in us way back there
with Sweden? Yeah, wasn't it? Yeah, this Rosendahl?
Rosendahl, yeah.
Yes. Well, you know, they used to call her Mustakoisa. And
call who that?
She was a...
You used to call Ann Ostberg that?
No, I think she was the sister of Grandma Hogberg.
Mm-hmm. Grandma Hogberg, that was Anna's mother.
Yeah.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I always figured it was a little.
Yes, it is a little Jewish.
I think so.
Way back, I know it is. Uh huh. So.
Huh.
But do you think there's any black?
Anyway, you see, when years ago, my mother was the type of a person. She was like a midwife to everybody. She had brought over 100 kids into this world every time somebody had a baby.
She'd go,
get Aunt Annie. And then when Violet's folks, they had polio and scarlet fever, and my mother used to walk across the fields to take care of her mother. And Violet always said, if mother needs to ever go into home, I'm going to take care of her. So we had no trouble getting her in.
Is
say Peter was a poor farmer.
Well, yeah, we didn't have no money. We had to go and hoe the potato fields, you know, and,
yeah.
And we had to milk cows.
So Rube never did any farming at home?
Oh, yeah,
at all?
He did.
He did his chores.
Dad went to Sweden when Barbara was living with sister. And then Reuben and Robert, my two brothers, they were in charge of the farm and all were they mean to us girls.
And they were, now how old were they then, 15?
Well, they might have been 17, 18, 19, something like that.
Oh.
And boy, they sure told us girls we had to do and then Reuben, when he had to milk the cows, then he said we had to come and hold the tails, you know, because the tails. And then before you knew it, there go that darn tit, you know, he'd squirt milk. Oh, Reuben with the teeth. And then he'd come in from the barn, and then he'd stick his damn fingers right up your mouth, and it was full of cow shit around the brown. Oh, I used to get so mad at him. And then he.
But you kids now were really young. You girls were really young when Ruben was doing that.
And then Minerva, you know, she had polio, my oldest sister. So if you made Minerva run, she'd limp. Just like if I was going to run now, I would limp.
Yeah.
And then Reuben, he'd hit her in the. How many times Reuben hit me in my shoulders?
Yeah.
And then Minerva would run and limp.
Just
you know.
Typical brother sister fight. Yeah.
Yeah. I said, do you realize when we were kids, we had a package of bloodberry gum to divide amongst all of us. I chewed on a stick of bloodberry gum all week,
yeah.
Add a little sugar to it, and then when I was through chewing it, we put it up in the windowsill,
sure.
And how many flies lit on it,
uh-huh.
And we turn around and chew it some more.
Uh-huh.
And then in the fall, you know, after Dad had a little money from his crop, he used to buy a great big barrel of apples. And every night after supper, he would go downstairs into the cellar and get a nice big apple like this for us girls.
Boy, times were different.
There were four girls at home. And then he'd take his pocket knife out of his pocket and he'd cut that in four halves.
Uh-huh.
And boy, I tell you, we sat there and ate that fourth of an apple. We just took the tiniest bite.
Wanted it to last long.
Oh, gosh. And I even got a fourth of a cookie from my mother, but you wouldn't believe it. But you see, when they went to town, oh boy, did we get busy, because there was 100 pounds of flour upstairs, 100 pounds of sugar. We had the cream can in the summer kitchen.
Uh-huh.
And boy, the minute they went off the yard, it was 5 miles to Cambridge. Then we'd start making cereal. We made cream puffs, and then we'd have it. And we'd be so careful to smooth out that sugar, you know, in that 100-pound sack,
yeah.
So they couldn't tell, you know, that we had taken some. And one time I made custard pie, two custard pies, and we set it on the porch. And we were going to hurry and eat one and hide the other one so Mother wouldn't know it. And when I come out to get the pie, the cats had come up from the barn, and they had eaten all that cream out, and all we had was a pie crust left around.
But now tell me about Peter. When he, what was it like on a farm? Was he very, very strict?
Well, I didn't start going out with anybody till I was 17. We went for a drive behind our ears.
Really?
Yeah, that's right. We went just to church. Yeah, we couldn't go out.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't.
Well, how strict was he with the kids? Would he scold them quite often?
I don't remember that.
In other words, did he run a real tight ship?
No, we never. Dad was awfully good. He was so much fun. He was. But I remember we kids were pretty. I can remember.
Okay, now, of all the kids, which kid got in the most trouble? Which kid was
Alyce.
The... Oh, really?
Alyce, yeah, she's... And Inez. But she'd get by with things. I remember...
I mean, even more than the boys?
Oh, yeah, I never heard the boys ever got in any trouble. Alyce and Dita, but they wouldn't, you know, they have a mind of their own. Alyce is kind of devilish, you know.
Even when she was really young?
Yeah, uh-huh.
Yeah. So she was the wild one.
No, I wouldn't say that she was wild. I don't think none of us kids were wild because we had so much respect for our parents. We didn't dare to do anything that would shame them. Mm-hmm.
Now, when you kids would go to school and learn English in Old Township number 3, you would come home after school. Would you go right back to talking Swedish again?
No, I don't remember that.
Oh, you don't? Okay, but now, Peter came here in 1892.
Yeah.
That's when he came
to
this country.
Well, he went to a little school.
Now, he didn't know any English over in Sweden. So he came here, he came to Isanti. And
he had to, you know, to be naturalized, and you had to go to school, you know, to get your papers.
So he did take some lessons.
Oh, you had to get your papers.
Okay, but he didn't, now Marguerite, or Anna, on the other hand, had already been here for some time.
She was 9 years old when she came, and then the father got the naturalized papers, then she didn't have to.
See, the Hogbergs had been there in that farm long before Peter came over.
Not very long, yeah.
Because Anna was born in 71,
And
I think they came in the 80s, maybe 10 years before Peter. So they had been here already.
Oh, yes, uh-huh.
Okay, so maybe Anna then would speak more English than Peter would have.
I couldn't tell you that.
Oh, yeah, well, when he went home, when they were around the house and around the farm.
Oh, yeah, we'd talk English, but he'd talk Swedish, too, and we'd answer him in English. Uh-huh.
Oh, really?
And we talked a little Swedish, sure we did. Uh-huh. We had to.
You learned a lot in Swedish.
Oh, yeah, we had to because we went to church and it was Sunday, it was in the Swedish.
Do you think that Peter tried to speak English as much as he could?
Oh, yeah, he did. He was on the board at the school. He was on the board at school.
I mean, he wasn't a rebel. He didn't try to fight the English language and try to maintain the Swedish.
He tried to talk English. You know, there's a lot of Swedish words that went with his English.
But I bet it was easier for him to talk Swedish.
Oh, I suppose it would be.
If there was 2 Swedes at church that day and they were out in the hallway talking, they probably would be talking Swedish.
I imagine they would,
So it was a kind of a conflict for him. He would come home and then the family would be there. He would try to speak English probably as much as he could. Now, after years went by, then English just came more natural for him.
Oh, sure, I suppose it did.